that I am yours and yours. And that's what we are going to study today. Father, we thank you for your word and every word that we say is the truth. And we have not sung the song, but we have been singing our faith. A faith on the truth that the word speaks about. Here we are, Lord. Let our eyes see what is hidden from this world. Let our ears hear your voice of the good shepherd and no longer the voice of the stranger. Lord, help us to understand and perceive your word that you are going to teach us. We are thankful to you. We submit to you. We resist every kind of temptation and every kind of force that comes against us. Lord, speak to us. Make this preaching and teaching absolutely easy to understand. O Spirit of God, have your way in our midst. Minister to every person here, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity that you have given us to be together to study your word. And as you minister to us, Lord, let not one of us go back home empty, but receiving the truth, come back with amazing testimonies. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Come on, let's give the Lord a big hand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah, please be seated. Brother Leo, just pray. And let's go to verse 35 to 44. Mark chapter 6, 35 to 44. And when the day was now far spent, his disciples came to Jesus and said, "This is a desert place, and now the time is far past. Send them away, that they may go into the country round about, and into the villages, and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat." Jesus answered and said to them, "Give you them to eat." And they said unto Jesus, "Shall we go and buy 200 penny worth of bread and give them to eat?" Jesus said to them, "How many loaves have you? Go and see." And when they knew, they said, 5 and 2 fishes. Jesus commanded them to make all sit down by companies upon the green grass. And they sat down in ranks by hundreds and by fifties. And when Jesus had taken up the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to his disciples to set before them. And the 2 fishes divided he among them all. And, please read that. And they did all eat and were filled. Read that again. And they did all eat and they were filled. And they took up 12 baskets full of fragments and of the fishes, and they that did eat of the loaves were about 5,000. 5,000. 5,000. So mostly for the meeting, the men are more than the women. Who are more in every woman? So if there were 5,000 men, surely there would have been more than that woman, and along with the woman, the children. So it won't be, let's say, 2 women to a man, 10,000 women, children, praise God, So more than 15,000 men and women, not counting the children. And how did he feed them with 5 loaves and 2 fish? Isn't that a wonderful catering business? Now watch this. And straight away, he constrained his disciples to get into the ship and to go to the other side before unto Bethsaida, while he sent away the people. And when he had sent them away, he departed into a mountain to pray. And when evening was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and he alone on the land. And when he saw them toiling in rowing, for the wind was contrary unto them, and about the 4th watch of the night, he came unto them, walking upon the sea, and would have passed by them. And when they saw him walking upon the sea, they supposed it had been a spirit, and cried out, for they all saw him and were troubled. And immediately talked with them and said unto them, be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And he went up unto them into the ship, and the wind ceased, and they were, come on, please read that, and they were so amazed in themselves beyond measure and wondered. Verse 52, let's all read it together, come on. For they considered not the miracles of the loaves, for their heart were hardened. Praise God. Their hearts were
hardened.
Their hearts were
hardened.
Now when you go and ask somebody, what do you mean by a person's hardened heart? Quickly, the answer will be, that person has to be arrogant, he has to be a rebel, he has to be a stubborn, he has to be full of pride and ego, a person who is all the time disobedient. But we don't find the disciples were arrogant, they were not rebellious, they did not fight against Jesus, but yet Jesus is saying their hearts were
hardened.
So what's the meaning of the word hardened heart? What do you understand by the word hardened heart? Jesus said their hearts were hardened. And why were their hearts hardened? Because they considered not what? The miracle of the loaves. Were they so amazed? Yes. So we pick up some points. They were amazed. They did not consider the miracles of the loaves, and their hearts were hardened. So in other words, the hardened heart is a person who is more focused on his circumstances and situations and the things that are happening in the natural compared to the things that God has declared in the word. So that person is more focused on natural things rather than being focused on spiritual things. Has anybody ever got married? Okay. Anybody married then? Hello, anybody married? Have you got worried about your children? They're saying not the children, the spouse. Okay, whatever. Now when a person is worried, what does worry mean? Worry means the person has focused on his situation more than what the word of God says. Now why is this passage connected to the multiplication of the loaves? We know that there was a storm, but it is connected to the multiplication of the loaves. Now, Jesus spoke to these disciples and said, give them something to eat. Now what did they say? Come on Jesus, this is somewhere in the desert where will we find food? And even if we find food, how much of money is required to feed them? Did Jesus know what he was doing? Yeah. And that's why he began to ask the disciples to see what would be their response. Would their response be in the natural, which we call as smart reasoning, or thinking on all that Jesus was teaching his word and focusing on what he was saying? Now, when they said, do you want us to go and buy food of 200, whatever, praise God, he told them, okay, make them all sit. So they made them sit in hundreds and in fifties. And then he said, come on, bring the bread and loaves. And then Jesus began to sweat. He said, Father, I'm in a fix now. Can you please do something? Father, please, they are all going to watch me, please, Father. Or was he confident? Say that confident. Say that confident. Has anybody ever prepared coffee?
Yes.
Before you put sugar, is the coffee always bitter?
Yes.
Always bitter.
Yes.
I said always bitter.
Yes.
How many of you have been really stressed out when you put sugar and stir it? That this time, Father, please, let the coffee be sweet. Anyone? No. Because you know. Say that, I know.
I know.
Say that again.
I know.
Say that again.
I know.
Say that again.
I know.
I know and I understand the very principle of sugar is no matter how bitter the coffee is, if I put that quantity of sugar, it will destroy the bitterness and replace it with sweetness. Because you know and understand. So that brings what? Confidence. In the same way, when a person has the promise of God, which gives the faith of God, and that person knows and understands the working principle of that promise, he is what? Confident. So, just like a man and a woman, husband and wife, when they come together in physically, the conception takes place and the pregnancy begins. After that, if you go and ask the woman who delivered the baby, how did you manufacture the heart? What will she say? I don't know. How did you create the kidneys? I don't know. What about the eyes? I don't know. So how come the baby came out of you? I don't know. I knew only to start the process. After that, I had to only protect the process, and when the process was completed, I did not have to do anything. What was completed, the finished product was out of my body. Is that right? In the same way, when a person has the promise of God, and has confidence in knowing and understanding its working, the conception has begun and the person is pregnant with that miracle manifestation. And when the process is going on, the enemy is going to try his best to harden the heart of that person to the word of God. Now let me give you an example of hardening of the heart. When a person is studying the word of God, he's understanding the word of God, he's praising God, he's screaming on top of his voice, and he's here in the church, he sees so many signs and wonders, he's all excited. He goes out of the door. And just then comes a call, which is a bad news. So he heard the word here, and he heard the word on the phone. Which word is running in his mind? Come on. What he heard in the church? Let me take your photo. Let's be honest. Come on. We don't want oral exam right answers. We want answers that brings results. Right from childhood, we have been trained to live by our senses and not by faith. And that's why our mind quickly The news that my eyes are talking about. The news that my ears are talking about. The news that the physical things going around and my mind is processing those things. And now when the processing is going on, I have hardened my heart to the word of God. And I'm extremely sensitive, extremely alert to the things happening around me. Has anybody ever experienced that? Come on. So when you see people who come to church, practically everybody, including me, when I'm sharing with you, we all go through times when the pressure comes, we harden our heart to the word of God. And that was what happened to the disciples, that they, when Jesus told them to sit, make them all sit, they did not know what to do, but they saw Jesus take those loaves and that fish, and he opened up his mouth and spoke his faith, and the loaves multiplied, the fishes multiplied. They saw it with their eyes. They saw what Jesus did. They saw it with their eyes. And they were extremely marveled with that miracle. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. My question to you is, how many of us, if we would have been there and you saw the bread and the loaves multiply, you would get excited? It's hard, you know me. Won't you get excited?
Yes.
Yes. Why are we excited? Because our life is governed by natural things. Was Jesus excited when the loaves multiplied, when the fish multiplied? Did he say, "Hey Peter, did you see that? Wow! My father did it!" No. For Jesus, these things were extremely common. For Jesus, he would be marveled when things won't happen. The Bible says he marveled when he went to Nazareth and he was preaching and he saw that he could not do miracles over there because of the people who were offended, and he marveled because of their unbelief. So Jesus would marvel when things did not happen supernatural. But in his life, everything was supernatural because he always lived by faith. And a person who lives by faith is a person who lives by the promise of God. In other words, he lives by things declared in the word, but having no physical evidence that you can see with your eyes. I'll give an example. Yesterday, we were in Sacha, and there was a lady who came who had met with an accident. And when she said, "I met with an accident, and they have put a plate inside, and my hand is damaged, and the nerve is dead." The moment she said, "The nerve is dead," I got excited and I said, "Wow." Why do you think I said wow? Because I'm confident that through the word of God, I can get the nerve made alive. Amen. So the moment she said the nerve is dead, I know, and I know medical science says that whenever a nerve is dead, it's dead forever. No doctor can ever bring the nerve alive. So the moment she said that word is challenging me to harden my heart to the word of God. And I say, wow, it's an opportunity for me to bring the glory of God, because this is something you said impossible, and God said all things are possible to him who believes in him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many of you were there yesterday? So that we know there are some witnesses, there are some here. Praise God. Hallelujah. So, after explaining to her that if you focus on what the doctor said, we can pray and pray and pray, your hardened heart through the word of God will stop you from experiencing the manifestation. But if you renew your mind and say, Lord, the Bible doesn't say when you raised Lazarus from the dead, all his muscles were alive but his nerves were dead. Hello? Does it say when Jesus raised Jairus' daughter, she was alive but her nerves were dead? No. The Bible says when she was alive, every organ, every tissue, every cell in the body was alive. So, we took just 3 minutes and we began to speak the scripture. In 3 minutes, our fingers began to move and she began to say, I felt some tingling inside my hand and now my fingers are moving, and she picked up a book with the same hand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, she could not raise her hand up to the ear. And I said, come on, let's talk to the Lord and let's tell that arm to recreate the cartilages, whatever has been jammed, to be lubricated with the blood of Jesus. And the next moment, her hand simply, smoothly began to go straight high. Now, I am not saying because I prayed. I am saying because I've trained my mind to harden my heart to sickness and disease. You might know the scripture and you might be speaking the scripture 1,000 times a day. That doesn't mean that it's going to bring forth the manifestation. Let me give you another example. How many of you are from Bombay? Wow! Praise God! And all those who are from Bombay, you know, in the local train, when the Virar train, the fisherwoman come, do you do any panga with them? You dare not. Otherwise, the topi will twist little and all the fish water will come on you. Do you know that?
Yes.
Do anybody have the guts to fight with them? Why? Because they are well trained in their academics. Is that right? Hello, are they highly educated? No. Now, my question to you is, whom did Jesus choose? Fishermen. Were they highly qualified? Then how come? The question comes. Those who are not qualified, those who did not know much of the scriptures on one side, the Pharisees on the other side. Wow. They are well trained with the scripture. They can quote scriptures every moment. How come the ones who have got all the scriptures in their heart, and these fishermen were very few, healings, miracles from these, and nothing from this? You know when the devil has deceived us? The devil will tell you, you are still unfit because you don't know the Bible from cover to cover. Has anybody had that issue? Because when you're trying to operate by faith, he tells you you're too small. You have to know more and more. My question to you is, have you ever seen that when the preaching is going on, you bring a friend who doesn't know Jesus at all? He's an unbeliever. And he comes and he sits there and the preacher is preaching. Have you ever seen with your eyes an unbeliever coming for the first time and he gets the greatest healing in his life? Talk to me, come on.
Yes.
Yes. Now, did he know the Bible from cover to cover? Then how come he got it? The reason is, what was preached, he paid attention and became extremely sensitive to what was preached, that he hardened his heart to his situation and circumstances. So in other words, you don't need more scriptures. You need can do the job for you. Can we give the Lord a big hand tonight? The Pharisees were the champions. But they were champions in the world, but their hearts were hard. Now Peter and the companions, when Jesus died, their hearts were hardened. When Peter was asked, he was with Jesus. What did he say? No, I don't know him. Now what's that? Hardened is? Now, when Jesus died, were they in hiding? Yeah, what's that? Harden their heart. The 10 days they were praying, and the Holy Spirit came upon them. Was the same Peter who denied? Was the same Peter who was in hiding? Come out of the room and preach the gospel?
Yes.
Now, was he a scholar of the gospel?
No.
No. But the Spirit of God reminded him of all those things that Jesus had told him, and he was so sensitive to what he had heard that he opened his mouth without fear, and the Spirit of God took over. Is that right? And 3,000 souls were translated from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. Now the same Peter and John goes and speaks to the man who is crippled by birth. They can see with their eyes that this man is unfit to get a miracle. But they also know that Jesus in them has given them the power to raise the dead. So they are sensitive to not what they see with their eyes, they are sensitive to who is in them. Are you understanding?
Yes.
The issue with us is that we want to get more knowledge and get so much of knowledge, and after getting all that knowledge, we are still sensitive to situations and circumstances. And how do you know you're sensitive to that? Because you are still with body. As long as you are with worry, you have hardened your heart to the word of God, and now the word of God cannot work for you because you have closed the gate of that word working in your life. So my challenge every day is not how can I get my miracle. My challenge every day is I fight against that thought that is going on in my mind that is to the word of God. Say that, deliberate. Say that again. Say that again. A person who hardens his heart to situations and circumstances and is sensitive to the word of God is the one who deliberately makes a decision to go in agreement to the word of God. And that is the battle of every Christian in every moment of our life. Praise God. So most of the time is our mind full of what God said or what the doctor said. You can go for a Bible study for 2 years, get the certificate and have all those things. But the question at the end comes, who are you sensitive to? You can get 100 out of 100 in your exam, but the question still is the same. Do you get 100 out of 100 in the midst of your situation? How many of us want the promise of God to be manifested in our life? Come on. Everybody. Do you know every promise of the Bible can only manifest when there's a problem? Oh my God. If there's no problem, the promise cannot manifest. Because when there's a problem, the problem challenges you, and now you're says, even though I don't feel like laughing, I still laugh because the joy of the Lord is my strength.
Hallelujah.
It is a battle for every one of us. Hallelujah.
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 That is why you see me all the time when there is any situation, I call people here. And I say, now watch this, how this world will bring forth the healing. And we see it all the time. Why is it all the time happening? Because I have made up my choice to be sensitive to the promise of God and not what that person is speaking to me. Do you understand? Now, has God given everybody the same anointing?
Yes.
Has God given everybody the same Bible?
Yes.
And He has given us everybody the same. But is everybody sensitive to what He has given? And that's what you see with Jesus. As soon as the multiplication is over, He forces them, He constrains them, He tells them, I want you to go to the other side. And now they are going. And there comes a storm. Now in the midst of the storm, what have they responded? They are responding on their natural strength. Rowing, and nothing seems to happen. The storm against them is getting stronger and stronger. Did they at that moment open their mouth and say, it was Jesus who said, let us go to the other side. It was not our plan, it was His plan to send us to the other side. And if He said to go to the other side, He will take responsibility to reach us to that side, and they should have opened their mouth and spoken what Jesus said. But did they do that? Did they remember what Jesus said? They were taken up by the situation. And now when they saw Jesus walking on the water, they watched Him. How many times we have called out, Jesus, come and help me. And Jesus' way of helping is not the way we plan. And when things don't happen the way we want, at once we are troubled. And they were troubled. And Jesus spoke to them, it's me. It's me. And then He got into the ship. And the moment He got into the ship, the storm stopped. Were they amazed? Come on, were they amazed? Was Jesus amazed? So a person who has not hardened his heart and is sensitive to the word of God day and night, he is never ever marveled with signs and wonders. How many of you are marveled when you breathe oxygen? Hello? How many of you are surprised that you're breathing oxygen? Oh my God, I'm breathing oxygen. Are you with me?
Yes.
So from now on, are we supposed to be sensitive to the word of God? Now when you get a bad news, there are chances of that person to go to Google and ask more details. And the Google will prophesy, if the doctor said 8 months, the Google will say 6 months. Now, is your heart going to get more hardened than before? You know how what you do? If you're going through any bad situation, go to Google, put that topic there and write it over there. Relevant scriptures for this topic. You'll get all those scriptures connected to those topic. Pick up those scriptures. Begin to renew your mind on that scripture. Begin to focus on that scripture. You can use the Google to checkmate the devil's plan. The same Google can give you what you ask. You ask about the description of the situation that you're going through, He will give you all that the world has the knowledge, and your heart will be hardened towards God's word. You use the same search machine and ask for the scriptures connected to the situation, and now when you get the scriptures, begin to ponder on the scriptures, ask the Holy Spirit to give you the understanding and the revelation. Now you are sensitive to the scriptures and you have hardened your heart to that situation. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's go to Mark chapter 8 now. Is it helping you, my friend?
Yes.
Mark chapter 8, verse 1. In those days, the multitude being very great and having nothing to eat, Jesus called his disciples unto him and said to them, I have compassion on the multitude because they have been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. Isn't that amazing? Jesus had an outreach for 3 days, non-stop, no lunch break, no dinner break, no sleep break. It was for 3 days outreach crusade, and after 3 days Jesus remembered that these people have eaten nothing. But when it comes to us, and if there is a retreat, by 1 o'clock the stomach starts talking. By 12:30, they start telling the preacher.
Hallelujah.
Because our stomach is ruling over our life. Praise God. Okay. And if I send them away fasting to their own houses, they will faint by the way, for divers of them came from far. And his disciples answered him, from where can a man satisfy these men with bread here in the wilderness? Now, in Mark 6, had he multiplied the loaves? Now, how many of us would forget such a great miracle? Hello? Hello? Will we ever forget? We always forget. Do you know what we remember? Our problems. We don't remember our testimonies. We have a tendency of recalling our problems. Even though God has done such amazing things in our life, but when the problem comes, our mind is full of... How do I know you are here? Because they quickly harden their heart. Means what? They stop looking at me, even though I'm so well dressed today. And they began to look on this side, so I began to wonder, something is going on the other side. So what did you do? You hardened your heart and you said, I am not interested. Thank you to you. What we planned, it worked. Thank you very much. It was all planned. That when you are deep in the study, you just walk in and do something. And what you are doing, because we want to see how does he look. What is he doing? Because what he's doing is going to help you in your situation. Aren't we so quickly distracted? And that distraction is going to come anyway when we go out of this door. That destruction is coming for one reason. The enemy wants you to get your focus off the world. And once he can get the focus off the world, he has hardened your heart to the word of God. Hallelujah. Even though I was looking this side, I still knew something is happening this side. You know why? Because the eyes which were fixed on me now began to move. Hallelujah. And that is why it is very important that when you are sitting here and somebody walks in, taka, 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 and you want to see how many inches it is. Praise God. So The disciples answered him, "From where can a man satisfy these men with bread here in the wilderness?" Now when they ask this word, have they hardened their heart to the miracle that they experienced might be a few days back? Has God done something in your life? Come on. Now when you're going through a situation, are you like David, who has hardened his heart looking at Goliath and said, "Hey, the same God helped me to fight the lion, the same God helped me to fight the bear, the same God helps me to fight this Goliath." Can you give a clap offering to yourself? I tell you why. When this child of God walked, there was not one eye looking at her. I was trying to see if I can see anybody. This time, every eye was fixed on the word. This is how we teach, train, discipline our mind from getting off focus. So what's your battle every day? Your battle every day is what you prayed, what you spoke by faith, and now what you are seeing is exactly opposite. And the devil is screaming in your ears, telling you it is not working. Let me give you another example. Do we know that Eve disobeyed God? Did Satan speak to Eve? Did he speak words? Come on. Did he speak lies to Eve? But did Eve know that he was speaking lies? Why not? Why not? Hello, why not? Okay, let me give you an example. How many of you believe God gives you victory? How many of you believe God gives you victory? Come on, lift your hands up. Now, all those who lifted your hands, you have hardened your heart to the word of God. Now, listen, please. I always say, I'm not here to check how much knowledge you have. I'm here to share with you the truth so that you do not harden your heart to the word of God. Please don't feel, "Oh, I lifted my hand. Oh, I'm wrong." No. If there is a mistake, it is a golden opportunity to take a U-turn. In Dubai, when you miss one road, my God, Jesus. And if you're on this plane, Jesus, you can't come this way. Is that right?
Yes.
But you have to go ahead and come back. Come on, is that right?
Yes.
Now, let us see why we harden our heart. Now, had God spoken to Eve not to eat of the fruit of that particular tree of the knowledge of good and evil, had God spoken to her? No. He has spoken only to? So where did Eve get this knowledge? She got it from Adam. So did she get first hand or second hand? Second hand. She got a second hand. Now let's take an example of Jesus. Satan comes and questions him. Turn this stone into bread. If you are the Son of God, the temptation is not turning bread into stone. The temptation is what he heard. "This is my beloved Son," and 40 days he's meditating on that word, "This is my beloved Son," and Satan comes and challenges him what God told him. Now, did Jesus get first hand information or second hand? First hand. He heard the Father say to him, "This is my beloved Son." Now, what is Satan asking? If you are the Son of God. So what is Jesus speaking to him? First hand or second hand? First hand. How is he saying to him first hand? It is Now, when I asked you, do you believe that God is the one who gives you victory? You said yes, because right from childhood we have been taught that. But you did not get a first-hand information, you got it from somebody. Now, when I show you the scripture and you see it with your eyes and you read it, and now somebody comes and says, God will give you victory, you say, hold on. That's a lie. That yes is not coming, because they are saying, for sure, then you will say yes. Give me 1 John 5. Good. 1 John 5. Brother, don't feel bad. I'm really missing your son. I'm not pointing fingers at you, because I'm also in the same boat. But the children are very fast. Is that right? Was the, is the laptop the same brother, or he has got a different laptop? So, I'm not pointing fingers, please. Okay. No. Let's study this. The laptop is the same. You saw his son twice. I don't know why he's missing today. Oh, he's in India. Praise God. Or others, he would have been here. Okay. Now. The laptop is the same. By the time I turn, he has already put it there. So, is the problem with the laptop, software, or the operating person? I'm just giving an example. Hey, look, you can laugh at me. Now, in the same way, is the problem with the word, the Holy Spirit, the anointing, the authority, or the person operating? Now nobody laughed. Brother, now nobody laughed. Okay, let's read it. For whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, our God. So who gives you victory? Nobody's not talking. Come on, you can see the first time information. It's not that I told you, I showed you. Who gives you victory? Hello, who gives you victory? When Jesus said to somebody, you got healed, did he say, I healed you? What did he say? So who gives you victory? Who gives you defeat? Your own fear. Your own hardened heart. So when you say, God gives me victory, you have hardened your heart to the word of God, because you don't know the truth. The truth says, your faith. And when you get this faith, you get this faith from the promise of God. So the promise of God is what God did for you, and agree with you, and walk your way. And that response of mind, that action of mind, that confidence of mind is what hardens my heart to my situation, and the manifestation is guaranteed. That's why there is so much of frustration in so many people who are doing their homework well. They are praying, they are confessing the scripture, they are doing everything that has been taught, but where you miss the mark is you're sensitive to the situation, or you're sensitive to the word of God. Amen. So, let's pray and thank God that He gives us victory. Lift your hands up.
Again,
but my faith makes my prayer work.
My
Then he has hardened his heart to situations. He is sensitive to the word of God. So when I am sensitive to the word of God, now I open my mouth and I speak a few words of the scripture, the job is done. But the same person is now speaking, now for example, you are saying, God, give me victory. He said, I never told you that. You are not following my system. Hallelujah.
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 Thank you, Jesus. Lord, please heal me. You are not following my system. I never told you I will heal you. I told you by the stripes and wounds of Jesus, my son, I have already declared you are already healed. So when you say, Lord, heal me, you have hardened your heart to the truth. But now you become sensitive and you say, Lord, you said I'm healed. I don't care what the report says. I'm going to stick to you. I'm healed. I'm healed. Because the Bible says I'm healed. I'm healed. I'm healed. Because the Bible says I'm healed. I'm healed. I'm healed. Because the Bible says I'm healed. Oh yeah. Yeah, I'm healed. I'm healed. Because the Bible says I'm healed. I'm healed. I'm healed. Because the Bible says I'm healed. I'm healed. I'm healed. Because the Bible says I'm healed. I'm healed. I'm healed. Because the Bible says I'm healed. Now, is that a prayer? Yeah. Is it a faith prayer? Yes. Will it work? All the time. Then let's have attention. Can I have somebody with arthritis? I love to kill arthritis. Come here. Come on, talk. Doesn't look like she has got arthritis. Are you faking? You got arthritis at this age? Huh? Oh, you had a call on that. How come you know her? I'm so sorry, I don't recognize people. Because you see, you kill so many, you don't know which one you killed before. Okay, now what's your problem? In the last time the neck got healed. Yeah, now what's the problem?
Arthritis for 10 years.
And now where is it? All over your body? Oh, thank you. You got your own mind, you can preach well.
I've had arthritis for 10 years in many places of my body.
And then what happened?
And I've been bedridden, I've been on lots of medication, but no much relief from the medication.
So even now you're suffering from arthritis?
Yes, yes. Okay. I still take medicines.
Okay. So now you want the healing. You want to be totally delivered.
Yes.
So now the question is, for you to get healing, which word are you believing in?
My wounds are healed.
How many times have you been saying this?
Many times.
But how much are you believing? The pain is saying, I'm still there. The pain is saying, I'm still there. The report is saying, arthritis cannot be healed, it can be arrested. I never knew arthritis is incurable. Because somebody came and said, listen, my friend, arthritis is incurable because the cartilages in the body are all worn out. The body, inside the system starts eating the heart. Okay. Let's take one verse and let's harden the heart. Give me, whenever you see anybody with problem with the bones, do you believe what Jesus did for me on the cross? I can receive it as my inheritance or I have to sweat for it. Because the word declares he has done it. What should be my response? Lord, please do it for me. No, Lord, I accept what you have done for me. Even though I can see all this thing is still there, I yet choose to believe what you have done for me. Is that right? So your wish is painful.
No, it comes in, it was painful.
some angle it gives you pain.
Yes, yes. Pain in the body.
Is there?
Yes.
Is there?
Yes.
Is there?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Good. Give me Psalm 22 for you, because you love to kill. Hello? Tell me honestly, how old are you? You're 20? Okay. There is so much of life still remaining, right? And suffering from arthritis at this age. By 30, what will be the situation? Even more bad. And how do you feel when she meets me when she's 30 and she says, look at me now. Come on, isn't it joy?
Yes.
Yeah. Come on. Read that. Loudly. Come on. As loud as you can.
I am poured out.
Come on,
my
read it loudly. What
all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax and it is melted in the midst of my bowels.
Read that again.
I am poured out like water and all my bones are out of joint.
Okay, read that again.
I am poured out like water and all my bones are out of joint. I am poured out like water and all my bones are out of joint.
That's enough. Look this side. Now say what did you read?
I am poured out like water and all my bones are out of joint.
Who is this I? Your bones are out of joint? My God, don't pray, don't say that. Jesus. Okay? This is the description of Jesus on the cross. Now, have you seen the picture of Jesus on the cross? Have you seen the crucifix?
Yes.
When you look at the crucifix, do you feel like his bones are out of joint?
Yes.
No. You don't see the bones out of joint. You don't see them. Even in the picture, you don't see them. But the Bible says that all his bones were out of joint. Maybe your bones are not out of joint. You know, sometimes a person gets shoulder dislocation. The person can't bear the pain. Right?
Yes.
This knee of mine, it comes out of the socket. And I'm supposed to stand only 45 minutes. I have hardened my heart to this problem. And I stand only 1 hour. Are you following? So, now the question is, are you going to be sensitive to those two lines? I'm poured out like water. Means what? He has been beaten up in such a way, his body has no strength. When you take water and pour it into any container, the water will take the shape of the container. In the same way, his body has become so lifeless that it doesn't even have strength to keep his body strong. Okay. Now, you close your eyes and repeat after me this words, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
Lovely, please.
Lord Jesus.
I thank you.
I thank you.
I praise you.
I praise you.
Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I did not know.
I did not know.
The truth.
The truth.
I knew the fact.
I knew the fact.
That I am suffering.
That I am suffering.
From an infirmity called arthritis.
From an infirmity called arthritis.
For the last 10 years.
For the last 10 years.
But now, I've come to know, according to the word of God,
according to the word of God,
the first hand knowledge of the word,
it is written,
Lord Jesus,
on the cross,
you were poured like water, and all your bones
were out of joint.
They were damaged. So that
my bones,
my cartilages,
tendons,
ligaments,
muscles,
and all my nerves are completely healed, restored,
recreated,
and made new.
Lord Jesus,
I harden my heart
to every situation,
every knowledge
of that sickness,
every feeling
of that sickness,
I rebuke it,
I curse it,
and I cast it out of my body,
In the name.
infirmity.
Your infirmity.
I'm talking to you.
I'm talking to you.
You infirmity.
You infirmity.
I'm talking to you.
I'm talking to you.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
I curse you now.
I curse you now.
Get out of my body.
Get out of my body.
I said, get out of my body.
Get out of my body.
Right from the root.
Right from the root.
And you shall never come back again.
And you shall never come back again.
You have no power.
You have no power.
No authority.
No authority.
No place.
No place.
In my body.
In my body.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
I receive.
I receive.
Complete deliverance.
Complete deliverance.
New bones.
New bones.
New cartilages.
New cartilages.
New muscles.
New muscles.
New tendons.
New tendons.
New ligaments.
New ligaments.
New nerves.
New nerves.
I'm completely set free.
I'm completely set free.
All the pain has left me.
All the pain has left me.
Not only for now.
Not only for now.
But for every day of my life.
But for every day of my life.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
For setting me free.
For setting me free.
It's finished. Not using this power is because you got a hardened heart. You heard her say that she used to be bedridden. That means this, what you saw, it happened so easily. Actually speaking, that's a big infirmity which we just now killed right from the root. How much time I got? Wow. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a big hand. Come on. Now, how many of you made up your choice, a decision? Lord, I'm going to deliberately choose to agree to your word. How many of you made that choice? Come on, lift your hands up. Come on, lift your hands up. All those who made a choice, Lord, from now on, I'm going to do it purposely, deliberately, agree to your word. Come on. Now they don't want to give lift their hands up. Come on, this time your answer is right and lift your hands. Let keep your hands lifted up. Lord,
I commit myself
to be sensitive
to your word
till my last breath. The supernatural like Jesus, because we represent Jesus on earth. Might be 3 or 4 minutes. But to get that 3 or 4 minutes, how much to preach the gospel. That's why Jesus always preached. He preached and then performed miracles. Whereas when he went to Nazareth, he preached, he teached, but people did not respond to what he teach and preached. They responded with offense. And that's why the Bible says he could not. It's not that he did not. He could not. Because a hardened heart stops God's miracle in my life. Is that clear? So let's go to verse number 4. Verse number 4, Mark 8, 4. And his disciples answered him, "From where can a man satisfy these men with bread in the wilderness?" Now, question. Have these disciples seen this miracle before? Yes. Now when Jesus asked them this question, "Go, I want to feed them with some food." Did they say, "Oh yeah, Jesus, we are all excited. The last time you did it, you will do it again." Did they say that? Was it in the 6th chapter, Jesus multiplied the loaves and the fish that he could feed 5,000 men? Yes. Come on. Yes. Did they remember it? Did they once again answer in the same way what they had the answer before? Had it changed their thinking? Had it changed their belief? Then, and Jesus asked them, "How many loaves have you?" And they said, wow, this time 2 extra. Last time there were 5, this time 7. And he commanded the people to sit down on the ground, and he took the 7 loaves and gave thanks and broke and gave it to his disciples to set before them, and they did set them before the people. Now was Jesus who told them, "I want to feed them," was he worried how to feed them? Then why did he ask this question? Why did he ask the disciples, "I want to feed them"? And he also said, if I send them away, just put the third verse below. And he also said, if I send them away, fasting in their own houses, they will faint by the way. Then why is Jesus asking them? He's asking them, giving them the opportunity to say to them what he said in John 14 verse 12. Can you put John 14 verse 12? Are you getting first hand information or the second hand information? That's why every time I speak something, I am giving you the written word of God. Now look what he says. "Verily, verily, I say to you, he that, so when he says he that believes on me, means he that believes my word, he that agrees to my word, he that is sensitive to my word, he that responds to my word, the works that I do, also." Come on, read it please. Because your unbelief is saying, "How can I read that?" Your unbelief is screaming and saying, "How can I read that?" Come on, this is the first time information by the Lord. It is written in John 14, 12 that Jesus said, "He that believes on me, the works that I do, shall he? So that means what Jesus did, are you supposed to do it?
Yes.
Hello, are you supposed to do it?
Yes.
Okay, let me ask you, is there anybody here who has got a hearing aid? Any person seated here, you have got a hearing aid or you got hearing problem? God, give me one admission. Nobody? Come on, one more last time. Is there anybody here who has got a hearing problem or using a hearing aid? if there is one, let that person stand up in the name of Jesus. But this is the time the Lord wants to heal you. He that believes on me, you know why I'm saying that? Because if you got that problem, I can call any person from here, any person, and teach that person, and the deaf ear will be open. Why am I saying that? Because he told me. You mean to say you heard Jesus say, no, I read it in the written word of God. And if I read it and I agree to it and I become sensitive to it and I put my faith and move into action, that word will work for me all the time. That word works for me all the time. I want to tell you, in Dubai on Friday, it's company off. Saturday, some of them have got off. In heaven, the word of God has no off. The word of God works all the time. The problem is, we are the ones who harden the heart and switch it off. He that believes on me, oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. Is there anybody who needs a hip replacement, knee replacement? Anybody else? Okay, you got one, but not so quickly. Anybody else? Knee replacement? Why do all the healthy people come to church? And those who are coming every month, can you please search for some sick people and bring them for the service? Can you please do that? Like my sister Liz, she came late, but doesn't matter. She brought somebody to church. Or might be in Dubai, you don't find sick people. I have to teach you, and then I'm going to call you, okay? And this is the word of God. You will go with a hip replacement here now, before the session gets over, okay? I like that smile of yours. You know, that smile says, good. That means you believe, you agree. And that's why you smile before it can happen. That's how you respond. Praise God. So, he that believes on me, the works that I do shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go to my Father. Praise God. Now, greater works, for example, I'm preaching the word of God, right? But do you know somebody is watching right now in India? Somebody is listening to what is happening right now. Eight was six. And he commanded the people to sit down on the ground, and he took the seven loaves and gave thanks and broke and gave it to his disciples to set before them, and they did set them before the people. And they had few small fishes, and he blessed and commanded to set them also before them. So they did eat and were
filled.
They did eat and they were
filled.
With how many? Seven loaves and a few fishes. And they took up of the broken meat that was left seven baskets. And they that had eaten were about 4,000, and he sent them away. So this time how many?
4,000.
And straightaway, he entered into the ship with his disciples. The last time, he told them, you go, and he went to the mountain to pray. This time, he got into the same ship. Praise God. Is Jesus in your ship?
Yes.
Good. Let's see what happens. And straight away, he entered into a ship with his disciples and came into the parts of Dalmanutha. Please bear with me. And the Pharisees came forth and began to question with him. And the Pharisees came forth and began to question with him, seeking of him a sign from heaven, tempting him. And he sighed deeply in his spirit and said, why does this generation seek after a sign? Verily I say unto you, there shall no sign be given unto this generation. And he led them, and entering into the ship again departed to the other side. Now the disciples have forgotten to take bread. Have they just eaten bread and fish? I have a good appetite. Yeah? They just finished eating and now they are in the ship and they go out to take bread. Please stop. Neither had they in the ship with them more than
one loaf.
And Jesus charged them, saying, take heed, be aware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the leaven of Herod. And he reasoned among themselves, saying, It is because, and when Jesus knew it, he said to them, why reason you because you have no bread? Perceive you not yet, neither understand, have you? I'm not telling you. The first time did he do miracle?
Yes.
Multiplication?
Yes.
That day did he do miracle?
Yes.
Did they eat?
Yes.
And just a few minutes off, might be an hour. Now they are again questioning, we got only one bread. Did you ever think that disciples were such? No, let me tell you, if you were a disciple, would you be better than them? Hello? Would you remember at least Peter would have said, we got one bread. That James would have said, listen Peter, don't you remember in the morning he multiplied for 4,000 people? We are only 12 men. Come on!
Yes.
But what were they worried about? What are you all the time worried about? Now, what is he saying? Why reason you, because you have no bread, perceive you not? In other words, do you not understand? When does a person's heart get hardened? When he does not understand how the principles of the Bible work. He has extreme working knowledge of the things of the world. And when you get more and more working knowledge of the world, you become smart in the world, but your life is always natural. But the person who is all the time seeking the word and asking the Holy Spirit, give me the understanding of the word of God, the person becomes sensitive to the word of God and he begins to understand how the principle works, and that's when the supernatural takes place. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So Jesus is giving us an answer. When does the heart get hardened? When a person has no understanding. Understanding of what? The world system or God's system? World system or God's system? Okay. Having eyes, see you not. Having eyes, having ears, hear you not, and do you not? So when does the person get hardened? He looks with his natural eyes and not from his spiritual eyes. He hears, but he hears the voice of the stranger and not the voice of the good shepherd. And he remembers not what the word says, but he remembers what his past bad memories and bad situations and bad experience that he's gone through, that he begins to remember it over and over again so many times that he keeps scratching the same wound over and over again. Have you been there? Ask your neighbor, have you been there? And ask your neighbor, have you been there? What's the neighbor saying? Now, for example, is there a possibility of a daughter-in-law hardening a heart towards a mother-in-law? The husbands are saying never. But the husband will not say if the wife is sitting next to him. Hallelujah. So when we go through some bad experience, That bad experience triggers our emotions and we harden our heart to the word of God. So he says, don't you have eyes to see? Don't you have ears to hear? Because what you are seeing and what you are hearing are those things which are facts. And because you are all the time seeking the facts, which can be governed by your senses, you remember only the facts. But the moment you start seeing things with your spiritual eyes, what the promise of God says, you begin to hear what the voice of God is saying, and you begin to remember what God's word is saying, you have changed your hardened heart. Now your heart is hardened to your situation. Let me give you an example, a hardened heart. Understand. Do you remember a man named Moses? Did he commit a murder? Now when he committed a murder, did he run for his life? Did he get chance to pick up his bag? No, he had to run with whatever he was. And where did he run? He had to run out of Egypt. And what was the way out of Egypt? The desert. Was he trained to survive in the desert? No. Was he a warrior? Yes. Was he trained in the warfare? Yes. Was he trained in the academics? Yes. But now, was he trained in the desert? No. But when he moved into that direction, was God with him? Yes. Did he reach to the other side? Yes. Now, he met Jethro because he helped Jethro's daughters. And now he met Jethro. Now, is Moses a prince of Egypt? So his clothes will be royal. His rings will be royal. Now when he meets Jethro, does he need a job? Not a daughter. Is it daughter or water? Oh, water. I heard daughter. Moses needed Jethro's daughter. Now, could he show his rings and his robe and say, Jethro, how can you give me a job to look after the sheep? They always think of sheep. Did Moses harden his heart? No. Did he humble himself? Did he take the job? For how many years? 40 years. When he saw the burning bush and the bush was not being consumed, did he turn his face towards that? Yes. And the Bible said, God saw that Moses began to focus on the burning bush. He left all the sheep and went to the burning bush to see how come this bush is burning, but the bush is not being consumed. When God saw that, he called out his name. Now God called out his name and he began to talk to him and he said, you have to go to Pharaoh and tell him to tell Pharaoh, let my people go. Now, did God speak through Moses? Yes. Did he send 9 plagues, one after another? Yes. But was Pharaoh knowing that it was the hand of God? Yes. But was his heart hardened?
Yes.
And because his heart was hardened, he would not allow them to go. Now, did God say to Moses, this time he will let the people go? And that was the night of the Passover. Praise God. The angel of death entered into Egypt, killed every firstborn male in the house of the Egyptian. Was the same angel of death supposed to go into the house of the Israelites? Yes. But did God give them the remedy? Yes. What was the remedy? A lamb has to be sacrificed and the blood has to be sprinkled on the doorpost. Did they follow God's instruction or did they harden their heart? They followed the Lord's instruction. They did not harden their heart, and therefore there was no death in the house of the Israelites. Did they all see the signs and wonders? Yes. Did they come to the Red Sea? Yes. Was Pharaoh chasing them?
Yes.
Now when they saw death, Pharaoh behind, the Red Sea before them, did they harden their heart? Come on, they had seen 9 plagues. The tenth one was the most powerful one, but yet they hardened their heart. They did not believe in God, but they believed in their circumstances. And therefore, they complained, they murmured, they grumbled, and they even picked up stones to kill Moses. Did Moses harden his heart? No. He began to speak to God and said, God, this time, what's the solution? And said, God said, take the staff and speak to the water to be parted. Did the water part?
Yes.
Now, in the natural, I want to ask you, if you are in front of the sea, would, and God says, speak to the sea to part, what do you say? When he spoke that word, did the sea part? Yes. Did Pharaoh, his hardened heart, chase the Israelites? Yes. Did God tell Moses after passing to the other side, command the water to come back? Did the Israelites see the whole army wiped out? Were they rejoicing and dancing? 3 days travel, just 3 days travel after the Red Sea experience. They did not get water, and the water that they got was bitter. Again, did they pick up the stones? Do you want to be a leader of a congregation that when they get angry, they pick up stones first to kill the leader? Imagine how what Moses must be going through. But every time Moses did not look at them, he turned to God, and God gave him a solution. And what did God say? Take that tree and throw it into the water will become sweet. Hey, how can bitter water become sweet by throwing the tree into the water? Did Moses all the time obey God, or did he reason it out, or did he ever question God? Was he always sensitive? And when he threw that tree into the water, did the water become sweet? And that tree represents Jesus on the cross. When you use the cross, when you apply the cross in any bitterness of any area of your life, your bitterness turns into sweet water. Only the cross can turn your bitterness into sweet water. My friend, no matter how many signs and wonders you see, your life cannot change. Your life changes when you get to the written word of God and spend time with the Holy Spirit and tell Him, Lord, I want to have a relationship with you. Not on some feeling, but on the written word of God. I seek you, Lord. I seek the truth. I seek your fellowship. I want more and more wisdom how to apply this truth in my life. Praise the Lord. The challenge is, the Israelites saw all signs and wonders, but their heart was always hardened when they saw the circumstances, because they believed the circumstances are bigger than God. Whereas Moses, he hardened his heart in every circumstances because he believed that God is the one who created and the circumstances are nothing. The same God is asking you, what are you believing? Can you come up? You can leave your bag there, and you can leave your stick there. Two of my brothers were nifty. Just take a hand. Come on, go quickly, man. Don't do that walk. Come on, man. Yeah, just hold a hand and just bring up. Hallelujah. Take it before and after. Hallelujah. You are clapping because now we are going to see the kill. Praise God. She's Maria. Praise God. Maria, I'm going to show you some scriptures. Okay? And when you listen, when you watch those scriptures, I want you to change your thinking. Forget about what the doctor said, forget about what's going in your body. In the next 3 minutes, everything will be changed. Are you ready? You understand my English?
Yes, of course.
You understand Indian English?
Of course.
You're from India?
No.
You're from which country?
Poland.
Poland. See, I don't understand your English. You're from Poland, doesn't matter.
I speak American as well.
Okay. Now let's go and see. You got an amplified version? Okay, give me from the amplified Hebrews 4:12. How many of you are ready for the surgery? How much time I got? 20 minutes, praise God. In 20 minutes the operation will be done. Okay, now let's read it. Read that. The word of God that God speaks is alive and full of power, making it active. Active. Then what's the next word? What's the next word? So that means the word of God has power to operate your hips. Not only hips, your whole body. Okay? So now, when the word is being spoken, your ears are hearing. That word is entering your ear, going into your body, searching for anything that needs to be operated. The word goes and operates. Because the word says it's alive, full of power. It is active. Active means it's full of action. So we are going to see the action. Energizing, effective, and it is sharper than any tool. If the doctor can operate you, he can operate your brain. No doctor in this world can operate the mind. But the word of God not only operates the body, it even operates the mind. Do you believe that? So, you believe on it? So now when I'm going to speak words, I want you to imagine those words. Just take the mic. Hallelujah. 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 Now give me Romans 4:17. No. And he will replace those parts that are damaged with new parts. No, 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 I'm going to give you. Hold on, hold on. Don't jump. I'm going to show you the scripture. That's when...
Regarding the cars and replacement and the spare parts, I know very well.
Yeah. Regarding the car, regarding the car. Yeah. Do you have a scripture or saying about your spare parts?
No.
No. That's why I'm going to show you. That's why I'm going to show you. Okay. Please listen carefully. He gives life to the dead. Two, he calls things. He calls things from the invisible to the visible. When he calls things, he calls them as though they were. For example, Jesus saw a blind man. Did he say, you are blind, or did he say, receive sight? What? Did he say, you are blind, or did he say, receive sight? Okay. He saw a paralytic man. Did he say, you are suffering from paralysis, or did he say, pick up your mat and walk? Which one?
Pick up
your mat and walk. So we find that Jesus always spoke from the invisible to the visible. You and I are supposed to speak now from the invisible to the visible, and what is invisible is the promise of God. So when Jesus spoke the word, the spirit of faith got the job done. The same spirit of faith wants to get this job done, but he wants us to speak not what is there, but what we want to be there. Did you get that? Yeah. You have now last verse. Hebrews 1:14. Give me from 13 and 14, brother. Said he, at any time, sit on my right hand until I make thy enemies thy footstool. Which of the angels? Now look at the 14th verse. Are they, that is the angels, not all ministering spirits? So angels are spirits on service. They are supposed to do the job. Sent forth to minister, sent forth to do the job, for them who shall be, you and I were born from the lineage of Adam, but the day we received Jesus, we got born again. See. You were born from the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
But then you got baptized in Jesus. The day you got baptized, you got adopted in the family of God. So because of the adoption that took place, you are now the daughter of God. So you are the heir of salvation. Yeah. Okay. Those who receive Jesus now. Because you are the heir, the Bible says, God has put his angels to bring your spare parts and fix them up. When you say hope so, I guarantee you nothing will happen. Because you are hardening your heart. Listen, you can be very, very decent, very, very looking good, looking at all, you know what you say, I want to talk it in a nice way. Nothing of that works. What works is whether you are ready to agree with that. So why do you say hope so? Now if I say, are you a woman? Hold on. If I say, are you a woman or a man? What do you say? Hope so? I hope so. So are you sure you're a woman? So are you sure about this one? Australia, and I ask them anything about this, Let me give you two questions, two answers. I hope so. I think so. Probably.
Maybe.
So I have this problem all the time. So the Lord said, ask them this question. Are you a man or a woman? They never said probably, might be. Perhaps. They said, no, I'm a woman. I said, if you're not sure, can you be sure about this? Yes, yes, yes. Now, I'm going to say words you are not going to repeat. But you listen attentively and repeat the words. And when the words are being spoken, I want you to use your imagination. I'm going to use these three scriptures. Are you ready?
Yes.
Give me a hand. Okay, hold this, hold that. Let him also do the job. See, if somebody else does the job, his confidence increases. But when he does the job, confidence over there also increases. Because if I do the job, he'll say, hey, this brother did it. Is that right?
Yes.
But if somebody else does it, you'll say, if he did it, I will also do it.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
Close your eyes and say this. Now, when he's holding his hand, the Spirit of God, of faith, will move from your hand, go into your system, and replace everything. Are you ready? Yes. Repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I thank you. I praise you.
I praise you.
Listen, you look at me and get nothing. Close your eyes. Concentrate, concentrate. Because this is the time everything is going to change. Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
I love you.
I love you.
I thank you.
I thank you.
I've come to this place.
I came to this place.
To listen to your word.
To listen to your words.
I've been taught by the word of God.
I've been taught to your words.
God.
God.
That your word is alive.
That the word is alive.
Your word is active.
Your word is active.
Your word is full of power.
Your word is full of power.
And your word has the power to operate.
And your word is
has the power.
Has the power to operate.
I believe.
I believe on it.
With all my heart.
With all my heart.
Just as Abraham believed.
Just
as
Abraham
believed that he is the father of many nations.
That he is the father of many nations.
Even though he had no physical evidence.
He has no physical evidence.
Of any children.
Of any children.
His wife Sarah. Had a dead womb.
Had a dead womb.
Yet. He considered. That God. Gives life to the dead.
Gives life to the dead.
God.
Calls things
that be not as though they were.
As that we were.
Lord Jesus. I too consider Your word. You give life to my body. You have called my body.
Healthy.
Your word says, by your wounds, on the cross, I am completely healed. So,
I now speak to the angels,
go forth, and bring those parts to my body, the new parts, from the spiritual, into my body,
just like the mechanics,
replace the spare parts,
in the same way,
angels,
you are commanded by God,
to serve me, and right now. You are replacing
every part of my body
and making them new. I believe it. And I received it. The operation is finished.
The operation is finished.
And my hips have become new.
And my hips become smooth.
Has become new.
Has become new.
New cartilages.
New cartilages.
New tendons and nerves.
New cartilages and nerves.
New ligaments.
New ligaments.
New muscles.
New muscles.
New bones.
New bones.
Joints lubricated.
Joints
lubricated.
Lubricated.
With the blood of Jesus.
With the blood of Jesus.
I'm completely healed.
I'm completely healed.
It is finished.
It's finished.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Now walk in the name of Jesus. Walk. Finish. Listen. Keep saying, thank you, Jesus. And every step you take, think about how were you when you were healthy. Okay? You can hold my hand and we walk together. Okay? And walk not with pain. Walk, how would you walk when you were healthy? Ready? Are you ready? Come on, let's walk. Thank you, Jesus. Keep walking.
And therefore,
my blood which was poisonous, is completely destroyed.
Is completely destroyed.
And right now, the angels
have put in
the blood of Jesus.
The blood of Jesus
that has purified my blood. Sanctified my blood. And I'm completely set free. In Jesus' name. It's done. Now what? Come on.
Oh,
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Did you see when you are sensitive to the word of God, how quickly she gets healed? How many years you suffer?
Almost one year.
Your operation is successful. The mechanics, the angels have done the job. Hallelujah. Will you do one favor? I could not teach much in detail here, but on the YouTube there are 5 episodes of hardening your heart. I would beg you to go to this teaching and hear it so many times, even write down notes, that by the time I come back, you will have, I can't use the word amazing, you will have many, many supernatural things happening in your life, which will be absolutely normal, because that's going to be a lifestyle.
Amen.
So we have overshot by 10 minutes?
5 minutes.
So will you help me?
Yes.
Because every time I get into trouble,